grateful. Well, I am thankful that I'm incapable of doing any good on my own. Yeah. Well, I'm so thankful that I'm incapable of doing any good on my own. Well, I'm so thankful that I'm incapable of doing any good on my own, yeah. Well, I am thankful that I'm incapable of doing any good on my own. Yeah, yeah.
Good morning and welcome to Lifeline. We are glad you guys are here to worship with today. We are going to jump right into worship, so I want you to high five the person next to you. Whoop! And join us. Here we go. All right, let's raise it up. Connect you to God. You know, sometimes we try so hard to be happy, so hard to be content, and we end up missing out and forgetting that God is near. Right now, God is near to us. Right now, God is near to you. And everything that you see was created by God for our enjoyment. This beauty that surrounds us today is a gift from God, and that's how much He loves us. We are His treasured children, and that's how much He loves us. I'm amazed, and I hope you are too, by how much God loves us. So we want to give a gift back to God this morning in our worship time, and just let Him know that He comes first in how much we love Him. And I hope you're amazed this morning like we are. Here we go, ready? Oh,
Yeah.
You know, when it comes to gardens, they don't just magically happen. They don't just happen on their own. We know what happens on their own. When left to their own devices, weeds just happen. So in order to have a garden like this, where there's actually growth happening, healthy growth, and you see healthy plant life taking place, there was a lot of care and preparation that goes into that. There's actually three things that I think are important for us to think about when it comes to our own growth that we have to pay attention to. That's up to us. There's a lot that's out of our control, but there are some things certainly that's in our control, that's in our hands. And one of those things is to make sure that we're planting in the right soil. You know, even the Bible talks about, Jesus talked about the parable of the soil, and he talked about how when you plant a seed, if some of the seed goes onto into thorny ground or goes onto hard, compact soil, that seed is not going to be able to take root. It's not going to have any hope of life. And so the same thing is really true for us. The question for us is, what kind of soil do we have in our life? And it really, to me, it's a question of an attitude. When we talk about growth, the soil of the attitude of our life is, ask the question, are we humble? Are we open to learning? Are we ready to listen? Are we ready to learn? So the question for you, first of all, is to think through, what's the soil of your life? Is it hardened to anything new coming in? Are you not listening to anybody else? Do you think that you know it all? You think you've been there, you've done that, and there's nothing new for you to learn? Or are you open? Are you ready to receive that seed that God wants to plant inside of you? Now, I know that we're in a garden where the idea of clay is kind of a bad thing. You don't ever want to plant in clay. But let me use another example that the Bible uses about clay. And it talks about the condition of our lives, is that we should really be like soft and malleable. You think about when you get that Play-Doh and it's right out of the can and it's soft and it's squishy and you can make it into whatever you want. That's the picture that God wants to have in our hearts. Of being able to be moldable and shapeable, that God can move it around. And the minute that we start getting a hardness to our heart, that's when we become the opposite of a place that is a fertile ground for God to do a new thing in our lives. So that's the first question. The condition for growth, number one, is what kind of soil do we have in our life? Are you open or are you closed? Are you hardened? Are you filled up with weeds and even with thorns? The second condition that I would say that makes for a good garden is that it is ruthlessly protected. It's protected from a couple of enemies that would choke out the healthy plants. Somebody has to come alongside and pull out the weeds. And you have to make sure that there's nothing that is taking away the nutrients, that's taking away the needed ingredients in order for these plants to survive and to thrive. And so you have to ruthlessly protect that. And it's not just a one and done deal. You have to come back and do it over and over and over again. And then the other thing is, you notice that there's a fence around this garden as well. And there's marigolds that keep out predators. And there's a fence that keeps out the outside animals and things that would come in and destroy. So the second condition of our heart, the second condition of the soil of our life needs to be, are we guarding our hearts? Are we guarding our lives against any outside influence that would choke out the life and the growth that we want, that we know that God wants for our lives? And again, it's not something that you just do once. You don't just weed once, but you come back over and over and over again. When I was younger, I would go down to my aunt and uncle's, and they lived on a farm, and he was a farmer, and I remember them always talking about a job that a lot of teenagers had, and it was that they would go out and they would walk the beans. All these soybean fields, they would go out and walk the beans. It was a summer job for a lot of young people. And what they did was they would literally go down the rows after row after row, and they would pull out the weeds, and they would make sure that the soybeans had all of the life and all of the space that they needed. It was an important part of that whole process of growth. So the question for us is, are we taking care to protect so that what God is planting inside of us doesn't get taken away, doesn't get choked out, doesn't get destroyed? That's the question for you to think through today. Now here's the third part of the whole growth process. That makes for a good garden. It makes for a growth in our life. Is that it has to be regularly fed. It has to be regularly fed with either plant food or water. Or think about all the other ingredients that go into healthy plants and healthy vegetation like this. You have to have the sun. You have to have oxygen. You have to have the water. All of those things mixed together, along with the nutrients that are in the soil. All of those things mixed together to make for a fertile place for growth to occur. It doesn't happen by accident. So my challenge for you, my encouragement to you, is that if you're not growing, if you want tomorrow to be better than today, if you want your future to be better than your past, the only hope, the best hope for the future is growth. So are you paying attention to the soil in your life? Are you paying attention to making sure that you're not allowing any outside influences to choke the life out of the growth that God wants to happen? And are you regularly feeding and caring and nurturing that growth in yourself and in the lives of people around you? We all need hope. And the best hope for tomorrow is growth today. In order for us to be a church that responds to the need for hope in this world, we need to be a people and we need to be a place of growth. Because growth is the only hope that tomorrow will be better than today. And I'm telling you, if there's any common theme that we hear in our country these days, that we're hearing in our world these days, is that tomorrow has to be better. It has to be better than today. Now, fortunately, there is a key to unlocking that. And also, fortunately, that key is not a mystery. It's not hidden. It's not some secret. The key is that we have to be a people and a place for growth. In order to respond to our needs, our world's need for hope, we need to be a people individually, and we need to be a place collectively as a Lifeline community of growth, that we foster that kind of environment. Now, we've already talked about the conditions for growth, but let me share with you just four expectations for growth. Expectations for you, expectations for me when it comes to growth. So that we can each gauge ourselves, just do a little self-check, a little measurement on ourselves about what is and what are the growth patterns of our lives these days. And then to ask, am I meeting even the most basic expectations when it comes to being a catalyst for hope? Am I meeting the most basic expectations when it comes to being a catalyst for hope through my commitment to growth? So here's the first expectation. The expectation is that growth should be normal. It should just be a normal thing that happens. That the pursuit of full devotion to Christ-likeness, to being like Christ, should be normal for every believer. You know, think about this. When a baby is born, it's normal that in those first few months of life, that they outgrow clothing and they outgrow toys and they outgrow things, little seats that we buy for them and we put them in. They grow in their size. They grow in their appetite. If you have teenage boys at home, they grow in their curiosity. They grow in the accumulation of knowledge of things and their understanding about the world and about other people. And really, that's exactly what the Bible describes. Jesus did the same thing. In Luke chapter 2, verse 52, it tells us that Jesus grew in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and in favor with other people. In other words, he grew relationally. He grew physically, certainly. He grew mentally and he grew spiritually. He modeled for us our RPMs, relational, physical, mental, and spiritual. We expect that kind of growth in kids,
It's just something that we, well, of course, that's normal. But we tend to excuse it as adults. Let me say that again. We expect growth in kids, but we excuse it as adults. It no longer becomes expected. It no longer becomes normal. We have to begin to see that being stagnant, that remaining the same, that status quo is not normal, and it is not healthy. If we're going to be a people and we're going to be a place together that responds to the need of our world for hope, then we need to be a people and we need to be a place for growth. That should just be normal. Here's the second expectation, and it's the word responsibility. And what that means is that you and I each take responsibility for our own growth. Each person takes responsibility for their spiritual growth. And then they take advantage of opportunities to growth. Anywhere, anytime, in any place, they take advantage of those opportunities to growth. Listen, the way forward with the problems and the pains and the ills and the injustices of our world is not through some systemic change. It's not through some system out there. It's through you. It's through me. It's through me taking responsibility for me and you taking responsibility for you and them taking responsibility for them and she's taking responsibility for her, and he's taking responsibility for him. It's individual responsibility for growth. So I'm asking you, are you taking responsibility for your own growth? Or do you wait every week and you religiously, no pun intended, you religiously tune in, or when we start meeting together, you show up once a week expecting and waiting for me to give something that would nourish you? Is that the extent of your responsibility? Now, I'm not minimizing that. That's it. We're glad that you're here. And I'm glad that you show up when we meet together. But if you're waiting for a Sunday to roll around or a live stream to hit your Facebook feed, you're not taking responsibility for your own growth to the extent that I believe you could or probably should. I mean, we would expect a baby to wait around until mama comes to feed it. But we don't expect babies to do that forever. We expect them to learn eventually to pick up a spoon and learn how to feed themselves. And then we expect them, as they get a little bit older, to learn how to make a sandwich and put all the ingredients together. And then as they get a little bit older, we expect that they would know where to go to get those ingredients to be able to get that sandwich together. And then as they get older, we expect them to be able to pay for those ingredients that they could put together to feed themselves. And that they would do that as they grow. That's our expectation as kids get older, is that they would take responsibility. And I just think that along with what the Bible admonishes us, it admonishes that we would, as believers, we would grow beyond just having milk as our spiritual meal to getting into something more substantive, meat. I think along with that admonition, there is also this implicit direction to also learn how to feed oneself. I think that's just part of that natural progression as we get older. Not only does our meal change and it becomes more substantive, but I think the way that meal gets fed to us changes as well. That's responsibility. When it comes to growth, we each have a part to play. There's no doubt about it. In fact, the scripture talks about that growth is not just a singular thing. It's actually a community thing. And talks about how Paul planted and Apollos watered and then God harvested. And there's a process. There's an engagement. There's a bigger picture that's involved. That the body of Christ is built up as each part does its work, does its own part. Now listen, I'm lucky. Our family is very lucky that Marcy is such a good cook, and she loves to serve our family, and she serves our family beyond what any of us deserve. There's no doubt about that, and she loves to do it. And it's, but it's nice to see every once in a while to have somebody else prepare a meal. So I get that. I understand that. That you take responsibility, you want to feed yourself. And it's nice to go out to a restaurant. It's nice to go to somebody else's house and have them feed you. And I understand that. But that's the exception, not the rule. The overall expectation is that we would take responsibility to feed ourselves for growth. We can't always be dependent on other people. If that's all it is, then we're going to be remain stagnant. We're going to hit a plateau. We're only going to go so far. And so you can take some small steps. There's an abundance of resources that are available. God's word is readily available to you. Even on the tips of your fingertips, at your phone, you can have the download the Bible app, and there's all kinds of resources available for you to feed regularly, consistently, continuously on what God wants to feed you and to learn how to feed yourself. That's the expectation, is responsibility. Here's the third word, is that growth is transformational. That it would bring about a continuous change in our lives through the power, of course, through the power of what God is doing, the power of Jesus Christ. In fact, listen to this, the words in James. In James chapter 1, he says, "Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves, but do what it says. Anyone who listens to the word but then does not do what it says is like someone who looks at his face in the mirror and then after looking at himself, he goes away and he immediately forgets what he looks like. But whoever intently looks into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues to do it, not forgetting what they've heard, but doing it, they will be blessed in what they do." We can't look into a mirror and then walk away, and then, what did I look like? Our biggest gap is not between not knowing and knowing. Our biggest gap is between knowing and doing. We are educated well beyond our level of obedience. Let me say that again. You and I are educated. We are informed. We are knowledgeable. Well beyond our level of obedience. So let me ask you this question. What do you know that you're not yet doing? Is it serving? That you know that you're supposed to serve? You know that you've got gifts. You know that you've got talents. You know that you've got experience. You know that you've got a passion for something, but it's remaining dormant. You know that, but you're not doing it. There's that gap. Is it maybe taking responsibility for your own growth? You know that you should read. You know that you can learn more. You know that you can eat every day on God's word, but you're not doing it. You know that you should be more generous. You know that you should be tithing. You know that, but you're not doing it. What's the gap between knowing and doing in your life? Again, growth is the only hope that tomorrow will be better than today. The hope for change is in your hands, is what I'm saying. To become different. This week I was doing a training with a group of leaders, entrepreneurs, and we were talking about growth, and we were talking about how in order to get to the next step, it's the habits that are in our hands, that are in our control. The things that we do every day determine how we're going to grow. That we don't grow in a day, but we grow in the choices and the habits that we live out every single day. And I talked about the change formula. The change formula is an algebraic equation. That's D times V times F is greater than R. And what that means is D stands for dissatisfaction. If we're not dissatisfied with status quo, then we're not going to change. So let me ask you, are you dissatisfied? Are you happy with where you are? Then you're probably not going to change. You're not going to allow transformation to take place. Dissatisfaction times V is vision. Do you even know what to do? And I've already said, I think we are all knowledgeable well beyond our level of obedience. We know more than what we're actually doing. So I doubt that that's the issue, but maybe it is. Maybe you don't know what to do. And then F stands for first steps. Do you know the next best thing to do? Do you know the next small step that you need to take? Small steps lead to great change. So what's the first next step that you need to take to be transformed by God? Is it to depend on Him more? Maybe you're too self-reliant. Maybe you're not looking to Him as regularly as you could and as you should. Are you molding your heart? Are you allowing Him to shape your values and your character and your attitude? It's the question of the soil of your life. Is that the next step? You say, I need to allow God room in my life to work. Is it maybe the next step have to do with relationships, a relationship with other people that you need to mend, that you need to reach out to, somebody that you need to connect with? Is it about advancing Jesus' mission? Is it about sharing hope, that there's somebody that you need to share hope with, that there's somebody that you need to add value to in their life? That's what transformational leadership is all about. That's what transformational growth is all about. Now, here's the fourth thing. The fourth expectation when it comes to growth is that it would be exponential. Exponential. We're not just talking about little tweaks. We're not just talking about little minor adjustments and I'm just going to think a little bit nicer thoughts. I'm going to be just a little bit better. We are talking about wholesale, exponential, transformational, big time change, allowing God to change us. When we talk about being a people and we talk about being a place that responds to the needs of our changing times, I'm telling you, God is wanting and needing to bring exponential change in us and through us. We want to be bigger people, not just a bigger church. We want to be good at what we do, but we want to be great at who we are. We want to reach an ever-increasing circle of people with the love and with the hope of Christ. We want to reach an ever-multiplying and we want to be always multiplying it and deploying our influence out into the world, out into the seven streams of influence of business and education and government and media and arts and entertainment and faith community and the family communities. We want to be influencers that way. You know, it's been said that there are five dimensions really to spiritual growth, to exponential growth, that churches grow exponentially warmer through fellowship, through relationship, through community. Churches grow exponentially deeper through discipleship, through becoming more like Christ, through becoming and helping other people to grow and to deepen their roots. Churches grow exponentially stronger through worship. It's saying we're growing stronger because we're recognizing that our power doesn't come from us, it comes from God. Churches grow exponentially broader through ministry, through serving with our arms out, the servant's towel over our arms, our sleeves rolled up, ready to serve. We grow exponentially broader. And we grow exponentially larger through evangelism, through outreach, through inviting one more person, reaching out to one more person, one life at a time. I just want you to imagine a place like that. Creating a place of hope together. That's what I want you to imagine. That we would create a place like that because we are a people of continuous growth. Because I'm telling you, people like that and a place like that would be in a position to respond to the need for hope in our changing times, in this changing world that we live in. And a people like that and a place like that would be a catalyst for transforming the spiritual landscape of our community. You know, when we talk about gardens and we talk about growth, we know that there are some people, and you may be one of them, that just have a knack for being able to make
plants flourish and flowers grow beautifully. And they can take even a plant that is sickly, that is on its last leg, and they can just work their magic and do all kinds of incredible things, and they can breathe new life back into it and make it blossom again. We say that those people have a green thumb. There's an expression that we have. You have a green thumb. Now, again, maybe that's you. Maybe you're one of those people. And here's the thing. When a plant is sickly, when it is withering and dying and it ultimately dies, we know that there's no hope for it. At some point, it's just you got to kind of call it and just kind of let it go. And you throw it away, you get rid of it. But you know what? There's a very different story when it comes to you and I. That oftentimes we get into a condition where we just think, oh, there's no hope. There's no way that we'll ever be able to resurrect what is dead in our lives. We're too far gone. There's no hope for us. We're too far away from God. We've messed up too much. We've screwed up too many times. We've tripped up too many times. We've alienated God too many times. We're too far gone. We're too broken. But you know what? That's not true for you and I. I'm standing here in a cemetery because it reminds us about the fact that God is the one that can turn death into life. That because of what Jesus did for us, we actually have hope in the midst of despair. There's a song that became a new favorite of mine, and it's just called Graves into Gardens. And the words are simply, it says that I've searched the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise and treasures that fade are never enough. Then you came along and you put me back together. And every desire is now satisfied here in your love. There's nothing better than you. Lord, there's nothing better than you. You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You turn mourning into dancing. You turn beauty. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. Friends, God is the only one that can do that. Our hope of new life, of new beginnings, isn't in anything that we do. Our hope of turning mourning into dancing, of turning graves into gardens, only comes through what Jesus has done for us. Let's celebrate that together, that He is the only one who can. You want hope for tomorrow? It's cling to what God offers us through what Jesus has done, the hope of life from death. Let's celebrate that and remember that now.
raising this up.
Hey, everybody. Welcome. Stick around for just a little bit here. We want to be able to share in a time together of in kind of a bonus session, if you will. So I hope that you'll just stick around just for a couple minutes longer here. We wanted to invite you to share in this. You know, we prepared these messages in this series a while back, and it's just amazing to me how God prepares even weeks in advance what we need to talk about. You know, last week, who would have thought as we were going to talk about value and valuing people that our country would be in the midst of another upheaval of racial tension. And this week, here we talk about hope and that things have to get better. Tomorrow has to be better. And the key to that is our growth. And last night I was watching the eruption happening in Atlanta, and more violence, more killing, more fighting, more rioting, more burning, more destruction, more desperation. And I just thought, you know, today the service that we had put together was a little bit shorter than normal. You're welcome for that. But I want to ask you to stick around just for a couple more minutes and use the chat
And I want you to put in, let's use this as a time to pray together. I'm going to lead us in a time of prayer together. And I want to invite you to pray along with. And I just got thinking that our role is as ambassadors for Christ, is that God has called us to be ambassadors of peace. And he's called us to be ambassadors of value, that we would be people of value, that we would value other people, and that we would add value to others as well. And so in the next couple of minutes, I want to read some scripture and not give a commentary to it. Just let it speak for itself. I think God could probably do something with that. And so in this extended play version of our, this extended bonus session, no extra charge for this today, but I thought let's take a couple minutes together and unite our hearts from your living room, your garage, your car, wherever you're listening and watching from right now, that we would blend our hearts together and on behalf of our community and on behalf of our country right now, and even on behalf of the world. So again, just put your chat, put some comments if you want to add your prayer to this as well. I invite you to do that. And let's just use technology to bring us together right now, seeking the one who really can bring hope, the one who really can bring change and really can bring healing that we need individually, that we need as a community, and that we need as a country, and in fact, that our world needs. So with that in mind, let me just read some scripture. And I just ask you to bow, and you don't have to close your eyes. You can keep typing. But listen to what the Bible says. If my people, who are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. In Matthew 18, I tell you that if two of you on earth agree about anything you ask for, it will be done for you by my Father in heaven. For where two or three come together in my name, there I am with them. In Luke 18, Jesus told his disciples that they should always pray and never give up. In Philippians 4, it says, do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. And then 1 Timothy 2. I urge then, first of all, that requests and prayers and intercession and thanksgiving be made for everyone, for kings and all those in authority, that we may live peaceful and quiet lives in all godliness and holiness. This is good and pleases God, our Savior, who wants all men to be saved and to come to a knowledge of the truth. So let me just lead us in a time of prayer. And if you want to add your prayer, I invite you to do that in the chat. Father, we just come together today. And everyone who is in a position of serving others, you know, they can often feel very overwhelmed with burdens and with events that are happening in our country and in our community and, in fact, around the world. So we're asking that you would strengthen every leader with resolve to do what is best. God, that you would cause each leader to be steadfast, to be immovable, to always be abounding in your work, that they would not be distracted, that they would not be discouraged, or that they would not be doubtful with the headlines or the news that's going on, that they would be a beacon and a voice of peace and reason and hope to a nation that desperately needs it. And God, I ask that you would give them tenacity to take really the great pains to maintain the path that you have cleared for them, that you've put them in this position of authority, and that you would guide that pathway forward, that you would protect their position in you, and that you would direct each leader to draw near to the throne of grace, to draw near to you, God, that you would just call them to yourself, that they would have confidence that you would meet their every need. And now, God, I want to pray for the families in our community, and the families in our church, and families around this country, families around the world. I pray for their for them to be blessed and for them to be prosperous, and that you would undergird and remind people of the permanence of marriage, that that would be a strengthened value in our country. God, that we would, in our families, model what it means to serve one another in love, that we would be dedicated to each other in love, and that we would even restore brokenness and restore broken relationships, that you would bring healing as only you can do, God. We're praying that for our families, the families that are listening right now, the families that are in our community. God, I pray for just personal renewal and personal moral awakening in each of us, that you would put that mirror up to us, and you would show us, reflect back to us the areas even in our life that are not pleasing to you, and that our reverence and our humility toward you, in the midst of that, that we would confess our sin and our brokenness and our waywardness, and the fact that we often do things that are so contrary to what you want and what is close to your heart. So we want to seek your direction, and we want to rely on you instead of relying on ourselves. God, I want to pray a prayer that we don't normally pray. I want to pray for those that are in the media and those that are in those arenas that have an opportunity to influence a wide range of people. I just pray for their wisdom. And we pray for them to adopt values in their reporting and values in what they bring to the rest of us, that they would be accurate, that they would be fair in their presentation, that they would put a high value on truth and a high value on decency, that they would be responsible with their influence. You have put them in a position of great authority and great influence. So we pray for them, that they would have clarity that way. And we pray for our churches. I pray for the churches in the Algonquin area, Lake in the Hills, and McHenry County, and the surrounding Chicagoland area, and all throughout Illinois, and all throughout the Midwest, and all throughout the country, and all throughout the world. I pray for their courage. I pray for their strength in this time, that we would all together be united, asking you for help, that we would stand strong in our convictions, that we would be bold in our witness, and that we would together meet the needs of our communities, meet the spiritual needs of our communities, meet the spiritual needs of our country, and that we would be a people, and that we would be a place of hope and a place of healing. That's our prayer together today. And all around, those that are listening, those that are watching, those that are chatting together, we say amen. God, may it be your will be done on earth just as it is in heaven. Thanks for joining us today. God bless you. Have a great week.